If I was the devil, given my goals of killing, stealing, and destroying, I'd want to get to as many people as possible, both now and in the future. I'd do this by targeting kids as young as possible with my lies against God and His timeless word, which most don't know is the power of God. I would build a reality in their minds that's much different than the truth about who made them and how everything got here. I wouldn't want their parents to know what I was doing. So far, I'm doing an excellent job at that. Keeping them busy, chasing the next big thing, and being glued to their screens. I know that whoever owns the kids shapes the future. When targeting the kids, I would start as young as possible by steeping them in the idea that the Earth has been aimlessly drifting around for millions of years, building a context for the rest of their lives that replaces the power of God, who spoke all of creation into existence just thousands of years ago. This will set the stage for the idea that all life today, including their own, is the product of natural processes over millions of years. I will get them to mistake the variation within the animal kinds that God created for the process of evolution from one kind to another, which should be easy to do when they believe there was millions of years for this to magically happen. I'll have them paying a homage to the God of unseen, untestable deep time, rather than God's creative power. If they buy this, I may even be able to get many of them believing they evolved from a rat that survived the dinosaur extinction millions of years ago. I will convince them that they evolved from ape-like creatures millions of years ago, and laugh when authorities expect them to act like spiritual moral beings. I will build and reinforce this worldview using what's in front of them all the time. Television, movies, YouTube, social media, public school education, the state and national parks, and all museums they visit. With teens spending over 6 hours per day on their screens and public schools teaching over 250 pages of evolution, over 50 hours of classroom time before graduating high school, that should do it. Even those who hold onto their faith will be convinced that God used a slow, murderous process of survival of the fittest and natural disasters to eventually lead to the human race, rather than God starting everything perfectly and then man messing it up. Many Christian students will end up with at least some version of my story, leaving a compromised opening for me to wreak havoc in their lives. This way, I will stunt their growth because their taproot won't reach to the first book of the Bible. At least, not the way it's written. When they pick and choose what to believe from the Bible, I'll have more access to convince them to live life my way, but thinking they are doing it their way, rather than living under the authority of Scripture, so that God can bless their lives. I'm not doing this on the cheap either, because I own the systems of the world. I'll conjure up all kinds of resources to build monuments to my lies of evolution and millions of years at virtually every state and national park and museum that even touches the topic of life on Earth. I'll build my shrines of evolution using taxpayer dollars all over America and virtually every other country. And most people will walk through these places not even knowing my deceptions. In fact, I'll have them thinking that only the smartest people think my way, and those who don't are closed-minded simpletons. To help solidify the idea of millions of years of deep time when they are young, all leverage their God-given desire to be fascinated using the beasts of old, the dinosaurs, anchoring their extinction to some random asteroid 65 million years ago. I'd rather do this than let them discover that billions of fossils buried in sedimentary rock all over the world are the result of God's judgment in Noah's flood for the sins of a world turned hopeless because of the fall of man. I don't want them fearing any judgment, especially their own, if they leave this world without the salvation found only in Jesus Christ. When my lies become widely accepted, students who want a college degree will have to take several required classes that soak them with my lies of evolution and deep time. Classes like geology, earth science, astronomy, biology, philosophy, world history, anthropology, life science, humanities, and many others will be filled with my lies. I'll get most people to believe that layers of sedimentary rock are the result of millions of years, where in most cases, they're actually the result of catastrophic inundation from Noah's flood. Most won't ever learn about places like Mount St. Helens, where canyons were formed rapidly with countless layers. They'll also blindly believe that radiometric dating vastly outdates biblical ages, not even knowing that rocks of known ages don't even agree with their radiometric ages. I'll be sure that hundreds of researchers are supplied with endless resources to go dig up old ape bones.
In the late 1990s, I was privileged enough to win the first National Geographic Prize for Research and Exploration. When I went to receive that medal in Washington, I was hauled up into those sort of magnificent offices up on the top floor of National Geographic, sat across from Gilbert Grosvenor, the then CEO, and Bill Allen, the powerful editor of the magazine. And they said something I hope all of you hear sometime in your life. They said to me, you can have anything you want, any amount of money you want, to do anything you want.
Then use their imaginations to make them look like early humans. Most students won't even know that you could only fill up a pickup truck with all the bones that supposedly prove human evolution. They'll think the ground is filled with Lucy's when there's only enough bones to scatter on a picnic table. It's funny. Peter even said that this would be part of my strategy in the last days, raising up scoffers who would be willingly ignorant about the flood and God creating out of nothing. I want people to believe that slow, random processes brought life to Earth, not a God who spoke everything into existence and will hold them accountable someday. Students who don't buy into this worldview will be regarded as close-minded and unintelligent by their friends. I'll even get by with professors openly mocking Christians who take a stand for God or the Bible, but I'll make ridiculing any other belief unacceptable. I'll do this during a time in their lives when their desire for sin and independence from their parents is the strongest, giving them a reason to jump from the path of life and pursue all the world has to offer. This will remove them from the path that would have brought blessings into their lives and eventually to their own kids and grandkids. I have big plans for the churches too. I'll make the world so much fun that only the smaller churches will hold to the authority of Scripture. But most students will find these dull and unentertaining. Many of the biggest, most popular churches won't even touch the subject of Genesis, fearing they'll lose some of their wealthy donors, with most of these believing some form of my version of Earth history. They'll think Genesis is only a secondary issue, when it's actually one of the fundamental reasons that teens don't view Christianity as credible. Some churches will even water down the gospel, leaving out parts of the full story leading some to convert, but still living lives my way, while some churches will still teach about creation and the great flood during the early years. In later years, they'll be working hard to keep students entertained, with biblical training taking second place. This will lead to students customizing their own version of biblical history, picking and choosing what parts of the Bible they want to believe and then follow. Without God's Word in their hearts and minds, they'll be much easier to uproot later in life, especially when they'll be looking for a reason to ditch their faith to enjoy the temptations I will bring them in college. My real goal is to get God's Word, which I know is the power of God for salvation, out of their minds and hearts. I remember how badly it stung when Jesus repelled me 3 times using the book. I can keep them powerless in the spiritual world if I can keep them away from believing the Bible. Leaving students without their only offensive weapon in the spiritual war that most of them are blind to anyway. Although I'd like to, I can't burn all the Bibles. That would be too obvious. So I'll do something even better. I'll teach them that the Bibles that sit on their shelves aren't even credible because they don't stand up to historic or scientific scrutiny. This should be easy because I'm drowning them with my version of the Earth history, and people don't fact-check anymore because social media has conditioned them to believe truths that come in the shortest, most entertaining ways possible. If I do this well for a long time, soon they'll be turning churches into restaurants, bars, and even museums. They will exchange the truth of God for a lie and worship created things rather than the Creator. To keep them away from God's desire for their lives, I can't let them understand that God's Word is really true. So I will snatch His words out of their hearts. Even when it does stick, I will surround them with tribulation, persecution, the cares and distractions of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches. This will choke out God's Word, making it unfruitful. The only trouble with my plan is the holdouts, who still believe in the Bible and the power of God. Without being able to take hold of their minds, I can't influence their behaviors as much as I would like. It seems like those who stay rooted in God's Word as real historical truth are much more difficult to push over than I thought.
Are you a Christian student looking for answers about what the Bible teaches about creation, the fossil record, dinosaurs? Download the Genesis Apologetics app from the iTunes or Google Play stores for answers to these questions and more.